So, there's this marathon, and these two people are in the marathon, hopefully more, otherwise it's a terrible fundraiser. But we're concerned with these two people in part A. We want to write an equation that represents the distance that Martha travels. So let's find out about Martha. Martha leaves at 10. She walks at 4 miles per hour. That is all. That's what we know about Martha. Right? And keep in mind, like, the question that is clearly coming up is, when does Martha, Carol catch up to Martha? So we don't want to take the distance, say, that in part A, we don't want to take the distance to be 26.2. We don't know what the distance is, right? So we leave it as a variable, okay? So if you were having trouble with this, obviously the answer was up there, so for me to just write it down would be all that helpful. So let me explain. If you have trouble figuring out how to write this equation, we have represent the distance that Martha traveled. Well, you know her speed, 4 miles an hour, okay? You know that she walks for a certain amount of time. So we've got these different things. We've got distance. Yeah, we're gonna get a different color. We've got distance, we got speed, we got time. If you still aren't quite sure, just ask yourself, after so many hours, how far will she be, right? How far will she be after 0 hours? Zero, of course. How far will she be after 1 hour? After two? After 20? 80? How are we doing that so fast? Multiply her speed, right, times what? Times time, the number of hours, and that gives us what?
The distance.
So this is most commonly referred to as R. Distance equals rate times time. You guys ever heard distance equals rate times time?
Yes.
Common formula. It's just floating out there. On the internet. Other places. So her distance is equal to, we know her rate is 4, and the time is whatever the time is. It should look like a T. So maybe we should put a little M. Oh, I'd have put a little M there.
Because her name is Martha.
Because her name is Martha. Distance for Martha is given by 4 times T. So we kind of have not a lot of room. What does, again, DM stand for? So M's distance. What does, well, the only other variable is T. What does T stand for? Martha's time. That's pretty important. Not just any old time, but Martha's time. How long Martha has been walking. Okay, so we go to part B. That's the same thing, right? Distance equals rate times time. Just need to know her rate. Need to know how long she's been walking. So distance for Carol. What's her rate?
6 miles an hour.
6 miles an hour. Can you just put T there? What does T stand for?
Martha's time.
Let's look at this. Here's time for, we can put just like T M here and T C. Okay, now they're different, and but we could, we'd like to have as few variables as possible, so maybe we could write an expression here that will take Martha's time and turn it into Carol's time. Let's think about that. So, Martha's time, Carol's time. If Martha's been walking for 2 hours, how long has Carol been walking?
Running.
Zero. She's been walking for 3 hours. How many hours has Carol been walking? She's been walking for T hours. What are we doing with these numbers to get this number? Subtracting two. We take the number that is in this column, we'll call it T. We subtract 2. So whereas T just goes straight into Martha's formula, come over here, Carol's time is Martha's time minus 2 hours. She's been walking for 2 hours less. That's why we have a T minus 2 there. solve the system of equations to, maybe the, you don't know what this wording means, but you can read this. Find when Carol will catch up with Martha. Let's say we're calling this DC and this DM. This stands for Martha's distance, and this stands for Carol's distance. What's going to happen when Carol catches up to Martha? How will their distances compare?
Equal.
They'll be equal, okay? Martha's distance will be the same as Carol's distance. Martha's distance is 4 times t. Carol's distance, 6 times t minus 2. If we have something is equal to something is equal to something is equal to something. When you have a bunch of stuff that's equal, any pair of those things is equal to each other, so we can set 4t equal to d times t minus 2. Oh. Yeah. Oh, I wrote, okay, at least I wrote 6 on that one. 6. And the reason why I went through that whole thing, you may have heard set them equal to each other, or done that before in the past. I want you to have an understanding of why we just throw them together, or just set them equal to each other. Because they both equal the same thing. They both equal the same distance. So we set them equal to each other, and we'll find a time when the distances are exactly the same. 4t equals 6t minus 12, negative 2t equals negative 12, and t equals 6. What does that mean? What does t equals 6 mean?
6 hours.
6 hours later, what happens? Carol catches up to Martha. When is that?
4 o'clock.
6 hours after 10. Alright, here's a slide. So now we know that t is equal to 6. Let's get rid of some stuff we don't really need, like this. Carol wants to reduce the time it takes her to catch up to Martha by 1 hour. How can she do this by changing the starting time? Again, we're talking about the time that it takes. So you'd expect to use this equation with the two distances set equal to each other. So how long does Martha want to take? 5 hours. She wants to take 5 hours. So now, if we went back to the beginning of this equation, we know that t is 5. But what do we not know? How much delay she should give herself, right? This guy is the delay. That's a 2 hour delay. But now we're going to change the delay. We don't know how long that delay should be. So we know that the time she wants to take is 5. 5 minus, that's the thing that we don't know. You might think that instead of leaving 2 hours after, she would just leave 1 hour after. It seems to make sense. But what you don't realize is that if she leaves 1 hour after, she's going to catch up to Martha a whole lot faster than you think. So if we want her to take 5 hours, let's find out how much of a delay. I was kind of surprised by it. 20 equals 30 minus 6x. 6x equals 10, and x equals 1 and 2/3. So that's 1 hour, and what's 2/3 of an hour?
40 minutes.
A third of an hour would be 20 minutes, and 2/3 would be 40 minutes. So how much earlier does she have to leave?
An hour and 40 minutes.
That's how much earlier she has to leave?
20 minutes.
Huh?
20 minutes.
Just 20 minutes earlier. Instead of 2 hours after Martha, Carol should start just an hour and 40 minutes. She should just leave 20 minutes earlier, and she'll cut an hour off of the time that it takes her to catch up. Because not only is she leaving sooner, Martha is closer to her when she starts, and she's running faster than Martha. So all those things together combined to allow her to catch up much faster than I expect. Well, now she wants to change something else. She wants to do it differently. What is this other thing that she wants to try and do?
Change speed.
Change your speed. So the speed is the thing that we don't know. Do we still know the time? We do know the time. We know that it needs to be 5. Do we know what her delay needs to be? How much of a delay does she want to give herself? She wants to change her starting time, and then alternatively, she wants to do this by changing her speed, meaning she doesn't change the
2 hour delay.
So still 2 hours. So still 5 hours total. Her speed is the thing that we don't know, but we do know that we want to take 5 hours and we want to leave 2 hours after Martha leaves. So we solve for x. 20 equals 3x. So x equals 20 over 3, which is like 6 and 2. What does that mean? Instead of 6 miles an hour, 6 2/3 miles per hour. And she'll catch up in an hour sooner. Any questions? That's your day. Get your tests ready. So, situations. So given Calvin's speed, which is 7 feet per second, in his head start, write an equation for the distance he will travel in t seconds. Integers? Yes.
Distance of Calvin equals 7t.
Makes sense? If t represents time from Calvin's perspective, yes?
I'm sorry if I have the feet per second, like 70 feet per
second. Oh, absolutely, sure. It's not something we normally do because it clutters things up, but yeah. If we do that, we can make sure that the units work out. Like if I do 7 feet per second times time, well, that's in seconds. And the seconds cancel out, what am I left with?
Feet.
That's right. And I want feet because feet is the distance that I want to. How many units there is perfectly fine. Given Hobbes' speed, write an equation for the distance he will travel in t seconds. So distance for Hobbes. 12 feet per second.
T minus 9.
So he does not get the same. You know, it doesn't have the same amount of time to do what Calvin is doing. Yes?
What if for A we put plus 63? For the 63.
Oh.
63 feet.
Oh, okay. So you said he was traveling 7 feet per second for 9 seconds.
Right.
So he got a 63-foot head start. Sure, that works too. So instead we could do this, plus 63. And then this would be what?
12
times t.
Just 12t. Very good. Because once Hobbes starts, then we could consider the time to be exactly the same, right? So that's another way to think of it. That would work fine as well. I don't want to be confusing, so this works. This could work. B equals 7t plus 63, and B D equals 12t. Also, how about D equals 7 times t what?
Plus
9. Because he gets 9 more seconds than Hobbes gets. And then D equals 12. Just regular old t. And notice Dean's equation here is the same as this one, isn't it? Only we've done what?
Distributed.
From the 7 to the 9, you get 63. And I suppose we could do the same as this one. We could do 12 times D and 12 times 9, so that'd be... What's 12 times 9? Yeah, let's see, 11, 12, 108. So we can do 12t minus 108, because he starts 108.
Oh, no.
2 seconds. Okay. I was like, is this
science?
I'm not sure.
Say what?
No, I just did like the little
dash. Oh, it's just one question.
Oh,
what?
Just one question. Oh.
So
what's out of 5?
Okay,
so
it's out of 5.
Distance of par. So
are you thinking
so
you're great?
I'm close.
Okay.
I
wrote
close.
What's
our
number?
4.
So I'm giving you a 4. I'm giving you a 4. I feel like you got that one wrong. No.
You
said plus 9.
Yes.
Minus 9.
7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7, 9, 12, 7
Yep. So if we want to find where it is, like the distance at which they will catch up.
12 feet.
12?
0.6.
12.6 feet.
0.6 seconds.
Oh, see, that's a thing. So what happens when I set, like the distances want to be the same, of course, right? That's the only reason we're going to set them equal to each other. We want to find exactly the moment when they are at the same place at the same time. Time and distance will be the same for both situations. Cindy?
1 second 45.
Well, probably, but what I asked was, what? How far will they be? What's the distance? So when I set 7 times t plus 9 equal to 12t, then solve 7t plus 63 equals 12t, and 63 equals 5t, and t equals what?
12.6.
12.6 what? Seconds, and I asked you
every 151.2 feet.
And how do you figure that out?
You just plug in t for
12.6 for t. Where?
In either equation.
Very, very good observation. Either one. Who can tell me why either one other than Connie?
Because they're equal to the distance.
The distance should be the same. In fact, plugging them into both and making sure that they come out the same is a good way to check your work to make sure that you did it correctly. Well, let's just assume we did it correctly because we were guided by the master. 12.6 times 12. How many feet is that?
151.
I can't hear because you're laughing too much. What?
151.2.
I think that's what I heard.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's how far they were. That's a very different question from how long did it take. Do we have to say that both the distances are going to be the same, set them equal to each other, get the time, then go back, plug the time in? Can we just solve for distance in the first place? How? That's kind of the important answer. How do we just, like, it's, let's call this like phase one of our problem. How in phase one can we have solved for d?
You have to switch the. You have to divide by t, so it's t divided by t, and then times d. So pretty much switch the t and the b.
Switch them?
Yeah.
How is just I just erase d and write t instead and write and put d here?
No.
That's switching.
You would divide by 21 both sides.
Oh, in this equation.
Yeah.
Okay, so t equals d over 12.
Mm-hmm.
That's it, and I'm done. And I solve for d.
Oh, yeah.
Not quite. Wait, what? What do you mean?
Wouldn't you have to find the other equation too?
Right, so what have I really done here?
You've switched.
Solved for t. Hey, did you come up with something?
Yeah, I'm helping.
We were talking about the equation.
Yeah.
Very distracting. I'm very distracted.
I'm sorry.
So, notice that the reason we set these both equal to each other, like this equal to this, is because they're both equal to d. What if we rewrote it so they're both equal to t? Can we do the same thing, except for now they're both equal to t, and now the t's are the same, and so we set those things equal to each other.
So 7t plus 63.
But,
distribute first.
Something we can do. If you can do it, you should do it.
Distribute first.
If it's possible, then do it. So distribute first. Yes, 7t plus 63.
D minus 63.
So d minus 63 divided by 7. That is.
And you can set those two.
So here's a different phase one. Yeah, set those equals.
D over 12.
We solved for t here in this top equation. We solved for t in this equation.
You just put them together.
Now we can put those together, and when we solve, you'll have solved for d and answered the question without having to go back and plug it in. Is it more work? I don't know. That's subjective, I would say. Subjective means you have to judge it yourself. D over 12. Now when we solve this equation for the variable, it will be the variable d. I'm going to multiply both sides by
7.
And 12. Right? What?
So this is
way
more.
Oh, yeah. It's a little. Yeah, it's
real.
Times by d on
both.
On
the
fun
stuff
there?
No. Times 12.
No.
And times 7. Because the 7 will cancel 7. On this side, multiplying by the 12 will cancel out the 12. And we have to multiply by the same thing on both sides. We multiply by 7 to cancel out the 7, and 12 to cancel out the 12. So we get 12 times d minus 63 equals 7d.
12d minus
1. Minus 7d, whatever we find out.
Negative 756,
I hear.
Yep.
Okay. And then 5d equals
756.
Right?
151.2.
By saying you guys want to do something fun, this is fun for him, so check his
thing. I'm trying to come through for you.
It's not fun.
This is a blast.
This is not a blast.
Cowabunga.
Guess we define blast.
Mr. Stewart.
Yes, we do.
There we go. That's a true statement. If you pass the hat around, it's going to be interesting.
The master.
Sure.
The math. Like a list.
Okay, we get it.
Master.
Yeah.
Math.
Like master.
He's the master.
I get it, but it's not.
Who is?
Welcome. We're having fun now.
Oh, no, we're not.
What is that?
There are just two equations.
What is that?
Just two equations. That's all that is. Equation one, equation two. Right. Can I graph the solutions to this equation?
Yeah.
Yes, of course. Can I do it for this one too?
Yes.
Okay, wait. What shape will this make?
A line.
And what will this make?
Also a line.
Also a line.
Okay, so the question is where will they meet? How will they intersect?
How about that?
So that's a fun one.
Do we have
to? No. No, but you probably won't learn and you won't do very well in this class. So,
it's not fun at all.
So we got y-intercept of negative 13, slope of negative 3. That means we can go down 3 and to the right 1, or up 3 and to the left 1. Give us the negative slope that way, because I don't have any more room down here, so I'm going to go this way. Okay, so there's that line. How about this red line?
Yeah.
How is that made easy to grab?
You could plug 0 in for x and
0
in for y.
Beautiful. 0 for x. See how much fun we're having? Y gets 2, and 0 for y gets me a positive 4 for x.
Yay.
No problem. Okay. So there they are. Where they intersect, where does it look like that is?
Negative
6, 5. Looks like negative 6, 5. Is it exactly at negative 6, 5?
Probably not.
Look at it. I think even from there you can see that my graph is not perfect. It does not. But if I want to assume the best about the author of this problem in the textbook, I want to assume that they did not give me two lines to graph that will intersect at like negative 5.8 and positive 4.75. How could I possibly know that?
Algebra.
Right? Just be guessing. Well, so my guess is negative 6.5. How do I show that that is the intersection?
Algebra.
Oh.
Algebra. Negative 5 over 2x minus 11. Grab that.
Grab what?
Negative 5 over 2x minus 11.
Why would I do that?
Oh, because I just wanted to try something, and I totally did it. I just want to see how it turns out. Please do it.
Why don't you do it?
Well,
to pass the pad.
No.
Oh, why didn't you do it on your little paper?
No,
that's not very accurate, right?
I don't know what he's doing.
Yeah, let's see if we can do it. That'll make our day a little
more
interesting.
Okay, let's all calm down, please. Okay, everybody let that happen. Complain about. Oh, that was confusing. I don't know what he did. Okay, so let's just cut to chase.
Fish method always works.
Oh my gosh, you guys. If this point, okay, I'm sorry. My gosh, you guys and ladies, please. If this point is where they intersect, that means it's a point on the red line and it's a point on the blue line, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what does it mean to be a point on a line? How does it relate back to the equation?
When you put
it's an input and an output. I've been forgetting to do this, but here, now we'll start. So it's an input and an output. You put in negative 6, you get out 5. So if I can do that in both equations, it must be a point on both lines. It must be a solution to both equations.
So plug it in.
So we've got 5 for y, negative 3 times negative 6 minus 13. Does that work? 5 equals 30. No, not 30.
18.
18 minus 13. Yeah, that worked, right? That is a point on this line. Great. If it happens to be a point on the other line, that is the one point, very unique point, where they both cross each other. Negative 6 minus 2 times 5. Is that negative 4? Let's find out. We got 6 minus 10. That is negative
4. Yay.
All right.
I have a question.
Yes.
Is there any way to do this without, like, guessing?
Yes.
Hey.
Well, it's too many points to be big.
Oh.
What's that?
That's an A for all the stuff I said earlier.
A for...
No.
A for 17. You get A for
effort. I did that too.
Doesn't go.
Hey, everyone chill. So, the question is, the one thing that I want to point out is you use a very important word. Guessing. This is just glorified guessing. Okay? Now it's better than randomly guessing, right? Without these graphs, unless I have like a mind that can just picture things like graphs really easily, without these graphs written down on paper, if I wanna know where they cross, I would just have to guess. I just throw points in there and they may be way off. I may be guessing points that are like over here and just have no chance when I see the graph. I know they have no chance of being over here or there. Anywhere else, but somewhere in here. That's what a graph does for us. just narrows it down. Your guesses should be somewhere in here. But Daniel's right, that is just guessing. Okay, but it's good guessing. So is there a way to do it without guessing?
Yes.
Answer is yes. Yes, there is a way to do it without guessing. Well, I'm just gonna tell you. You're gonna have to like
solve for x and solve for y.
How does that? How do you mean solve for x and solve for y?
You put them together.
You have to make them equal each other.
Yeah.
Is that
system of
equations? Yeah, it's a system of. You guys done systems of equations
before? No, but that's
a system. This is called the systems of equation. The system of equations.
I already did that. That's only got the y.
A system of equations is some equations. they're working together. We're trying to find the
make
solutions of all of them. Okay. So let's take this on to the tell me when. Is that copy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And is this one?
Yeah,
based. Okay. So you say we should set them equal to each other, and that you're correct. And let's just take like 1 minute and explain why. Because remember what we just found the solution, it was a point, right? Is -6, 5. What we're looking for, let's say we're just blind. We don't know what that point is. We don't have any good guesses. We have an x, y. Okay? So if I put this x here and here, and I put this y here and here, and you get the same thing. So the same x and the same y work in both equations. You're wondering if we've already said that. We have. We've already said that, but we're saying it again. We're looking for the x and the y that work in this equation and this equation. That's the same as the one that we've taken the concrete, like Carol and Martha, Calvin and Hobbes, all these different situations, the Ditto machine and the Xerox machine. We've taken the concrete, like a real world example. We're going to move into the abstract. It's kind of what algebra is about. In the abstract of just these two equations. What's a solution to both of them? Or they're two graphs. Where do they cross? They're going to be two lines are going to cross once. Some graphs cross twice. Right? If you had a curve and then a line, that line's going to go through that parabola twice, probably, right? Or not at all, or exactly once. But possibly twice. So we're looking for the same x and the same y. How are we going to set them equal to each other?
You have to make the other one.
Nate?
I think it's you. Either set the x or the y to 0.
If you set the x to 0, now see what you're doing? You're telling x to be 0. Maybe x isn't supposed to be 0. You know what I'm saying? Maybe x is supposed to be -6. You know what I'm saying? So you want to leave x and y free to vary.
Do you want
to solve for them?
Do you want to switch it over or make them look the same?
Yeah, just like this is why I talked about this a minute ago with Calvin and Hobbes thing. We can solve for t and then go find d, or we could just switch it around, solve for t here, and then plug it in, and we'll have solved for d, and we'll go back and find t. We just need to get them to be either y equals or x equals. And now, if they're both y equals, their y's the same, we can set them equal to each other and solve for x. If we have them both equal to x, we can set them equal to each other and solve for y. Did I take your comment away? I'm sorry. So this one's already solved for y. So you know it'd probably be pretty simple to go ahead and solve for y on this red one. Yeah. -2y. How did I grab that? That's right. Equals -4 plus x. Divide by -2y equals +2 minus 1/2 x. So now we have something that's equal, what's that? No? Oh, bless you. Y equals this. Y also equals this. If we want to find, if we want to make them be the same y, this y is equal to that y, which means this thing is equal to that thing. So -3x minus 13 equals 2 minus 1/2 x. There's the answer to Daniel's question. Yes, there is a way to do it exactly right. The first time, no guessing.
So then
what
do you just solve for x?
You just solve for x.
How would that get you here?
Well, it gives you x, and how many we find y? Cindy?
Plug in s.
Into which one?
Either
one, exactly. So, here's, I'm going to suggest this, because we have this fraction in here. I want you to remember this whenever you have an equation with fractions all over the place. I could like add 3x to both sides and then find a common denominator, and that would work beautifully. But more beautifully, I'm going to multiply this side by 2 and this side by 2. Why do you think I would multiply by 2? When I distribute the 2, the only reason I'm doing this is because when I distribute the 2 to the 1/2, it cancels out the denominator. And I won't have any fractions to deal with. So I get negative 6x minus 26 equals 4 minus x. And it just makes life easier.
That's
smart. So negative 30 equals 5x. X equals negative 6. Are we surprised that it's negative 6?
No.
Why not?
We
just did that, right? We guessed at the point, and we happened to be lucky and guessed right the first time. So we could have guessed something else, but it just looked closest to negative 6, 5. So now x is negative 6, and as Cindy said, to find y, just plug it into one of the equations. Which one would you plug it into?
The one
with
the fraction.
I like the one with the fraction, too. That's an idea. So I do that one. Y equals negative 3 times negative 6 minus 13. 18 minus 13, you get 5. Y equals 5. So the solution to this system of equations is the one point that works in both equations, and that is negative 6, 5. Danielle.
Can you solve for y before you, and then plug in y?
How would you do that? How would we solve for y first?
I don't know. I
would. Well, how is it that we, let's like backtrack. How did we wind up solving for x first? Let's see where that came from. It came from these two being set equal to each other. What's that?
So because you left set equal to each other
the other way.
The other way.
Yeah.
And then you could
get this equal to x, get that
yeah.
equal to x, and then set when you set those two things equal to each other, you'll have y's on both sides.
So it's just the opposite. And then you plug in the y's.
And you figure out x. But it's not unreasonable for you to ask yourself, what would be the easiest thing to do? It's okay to do the easiest thing in some respects. So those are our two main approaches. What was the first approach to finding the solution to the system of equations? Guessing based on
points on the graph.
Points on the graph.
Pink.
Yeah, based on points on the graph. Yes. What was the other way?
Putting them.
So that would be called algebraically.
Algebraically.
Algebra is where we use variables to represent numbers, letters to represent numbers, and we do the same thing to both sides to solve for the unknown value. That's algebra. These are good.
Maybe we should have 2-minute break.
That's a great idea. That would make me happier. Let's have a 3-minute.
Cause
Woo.
Halloween.
And, you know.
5 minutes.
The Halloween minute.
That's
two.
You know.
Black.
Why
are
they called black tea?
Wait a minute. What's that?
Why is it called black tea?
Oh, this is the tea timer. That, but it was just a timer that I downloaded, and it works just fine. Okay, so we're gonna solve this system of equations.
Yay.
Oh, go, do it.
Do it.
Okay.
Do it.
Okay.
Fine, you guys.
Fine.
Watch this. So I solved them for y both. Are we all there?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see what happens. While I'm working on this, I just want you to think about these guys' graphs for a second. Just give that a thought for a second. Negative 3/4 x plus 9/2. If you don't get my hint there, we'll come back to it and look at it together. 9/4.
So their slope is
the same.
Yeah.
Their slope is the same.
They're parallel.
Oh, you can parallel lines.
trace of zero. I'll add 3/4 x. 3/4 x to both sides, and I get 9/2 equals 9/4. What do you say about that?
No.
Is it true?
No.
It's not true. Sometimes you'll do this and it'll be true. That'll mean something else. But it's not true. Meaning, there is no value for x that you could plug into this equation that will make it true. It will never be true. Because think about it. You're trying to take 9/4 and 9/2.
I was really trying, and I thought that I was doing something wrong.
Isn't it a better feeling to realize I'm just doing it right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so we're trying to take 9/4 and 9/2 and take the same amount from both of them, the exact same amount from both of them, and then get the same thing. There's no way you can do that. There's no way to do that. Okay. So, notice that we have the same slopes, so they're parallel, which means they'll never cross, which means this system
is not true.
Has
no
solutions.
Nine.
Okay, so vocabulary corner. No solution.
Make it sound like double minutes.
Huh?
Make it the right solution.
What?
Just continue.
No solution. Okay, there's a word for that. It's just vocabulary. Okay, we call this system an inconsistent. Okay, inconsistent system.
No solution.
Next.
Wait, I didn't get
your The word inconsistent means there's no solution to that system.
Inconsistent.
Okay, let's solve this one. Solve this system.
NY.
If you multiply this by -2, you get +4x, -10y. +18, exact same thing. What does it mean?
Parallel.
They're the exact same line.
They are their exact same equation will make the exact same line, which means
so
what about
intersect at
every
point.
They intersect, yeah, at every point on the line. They
Why
intersect.
Are you evil? Because it's Halloween.
Because it's Halloween.
I actually got that.
You figured out
too. So,
yeah,
let's see, 2/5 x minus. Are they doing
this?
Is
it
a consistent system?
It is consistent because it does have a solution.
And
awesome. Right? What happens when we solve it for y?
Zero. You get that thing.
When you solve for y, you get the exact same thing.
Yeah.
We're not surprised. When we set them equal to each other, okay, we already it was already stated that this is the exact same line, just written again. Let's see now. Maybe you don't notice that as you're just chugging along in your homework. Okay, let's see what happens at the end, and it's kind of like, well, that's weird. And then we notice something. So I'll subtract 2/5 x from both sides. They'll just cancel each other out. We get -9/5 equals -9/5. Okay, is that true?
Yes.
Yes. So in this case, there is no value of x you could plug in that would make it true. And here, there's no value of x that you can plug in that would make it false. Any value of x will solve this equation, right? Now that doesn't mean that you can. It doesn't mean that you can randomly choose any x and y, right? Because for every x, there's exactly one y that works in that equation. But if you plug in, say, 3 into both these equations, you're going to get the exact same y in both of these equations. Every value of x you plug in here will give the same value of y in both equations, meaning.
Consistent.
So
if you plug in any number in y, you'll get the same.
The same x.
Mm-hmm.
How many solutions does the system have?
An
infinite number of solutions. So I was just chomping at the bit to answer.
Oh,
jeez.
Nate,
come on,
that almost
Nate.
Hit me in the face.
Oh,
yeah.
Get angry at.
How many infinite? An infinite solution. Infinite number of solutions.
Consistent.
Is consistent because it has a solution.
So
I don't know why mathematicians choose these words sometimes.
You should start making up the words.
Yeah, that'll make it easier for you to like test and stuff. Alright, now I'm going to show you yet another way to solve a system of equations. Let's say we have 2x. Two x plus 5y equals 14, and 3x minus 2y equals negative 36. Okay, so I'm gonna do a couple of things that you may not like. It's not gonna be immediately obvious why in the world I'm doing this. Okay, but we can do anything to both sides of the equation we want, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so here's what I'm going to choose to do. In this equation, I'm going to multiply both sides by 2.
This is the way I know how to do it. I don't know how to do it the other way. I know how to do it this way.
Well, you better get on board with the first way.
I'm trying.
And this one we're going to multiply by 5. Okay? Wow. Don't shout it out. If you know, don't shout it out. 2 times 2x is 4x. 2 times 5y. 10y, 2 times 14 is 28. Okay, this equation goes to 15x minus 10y equals negative 180. Of course it's 180. What am I thinking? 180. Okay. So, can we do the same thing to both sides of an equation? That's the first thing I want you to answer.
Yeah.
Sure.
Anything.
Anything.
As long as it's the same.
Yeah.
Even if it looks weird.
Yes.
Okay. Now, is negative 180 the same as 15x minus 10y?
Yes.
It is.
Yeah.
In this problem, it is. Negative 180 is the same as 15x minus 10y. Okay? So, if this is the same as this, then if I add negative 180 to this side, and I add 15x minus 10y to this side, I've done the same thing on both sides.
Yes.
To this equation. Equivalent actions.
Now it's just
now we have 19x, no y's, negative 172. Is that right?
No.
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 It would be negative 152.
52. Can we solve for x?
Yeah.
Give me a second.
Dude, that was cool.
8.
Negative 8?
I like that way.
Called the elimination method. Why do you think that is?
Because you eliminated.
You eliminated y. It's gone.
I kept trying to solve the first ones that way, and then I was like, wait, this is completely wrong. And then I had to like backtrack and like restart. And then I finally got it the last time. But.
So now you get the first way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Almost.
All right. That's called the substitution method. You substitute this thing for y and set them equal to each other. This is called the elimination method. That
is
eliminated
method.
This is elimination.
The last one
is called substitution.
Wait, this one's substitution?
This one's elimination. The last one.
Because you eliminate one of the variables.
That's what I thought.
How do we figure out why? We get negative 8 for x into, I don't know, this one, because it's got kind of small numbers. 2 times negative 8 plus 5y. 14, negative 16, plus 5y, 14, negative 5y,
equals
30y equals 6. So the solution to this system is
negative
6. That's the one point that works in both these equations.
I like this.
Yeah, it's fun, I told you.
It's not fun, but
fun Halloween fun.
Halloween fun!
I wouldn't say that it was fun.
Let's solve the circumference of candy.
What?
Well,
that would actually been kind
of
fun.
You tricked us. Where's our treat?
How about if we have fun by having 10 minutes to do homework?
Yeah! Yeah. That's fun too!
I like it.
Mr. Stewart, sit down.